refuse to give ourselves to principles, we cut short our own lives.
Listen to me, my people. Hear me, my nation. The law will go out from me. My justice will become a light to the nations. My righteousness draws near speedily. My salvation is on the way. And my arm will bring justice to the nations. The islands will look to me and wait in hope for my arm. Lift up your eyes to the heavens. Look at the earth beneath. The heavens will vanish like smoke. The earth will wear out like a garment, and its inhabitants die like flies. But my salvation will last forever. My righteousness will never fail. Hear me, you who know what is right, you people who have my law in your hearts. Do not fear the reproach of men, or be terrified by their insults. For the moth will eat them up like a garment, the worm will devour them like wool. But my righteousness will last forever, my salvation through all generations. Awake, awake, clothe yourself with strength. O arm of the Lord, awake as in days gone by, as in generations of old. Was it not you who cut Rahab to pieces, who pierced that monster through? And then it continues, that's up to verse 9. I expect that everybody would say an amen already, because this is the blessing that the Lord has given you and I. And last week I did mention about how the word is relevant to us today, and this is the word that God will have us to know. And this is a prophecy to each one of us. We know that the word of God is prophecy, right? So this is the prophetic word to each one of us as we're here. The promises in here is for you and I. Verse 3 says, the Lord will surely comfort Zion. Now you and I know that if you say surely, it means that it's very important, okay? So it means that most definitely he will do what? He will comfort Zion. And will look with compassion on all her ruins. So the Lord is telling you and I that he will surely comfort us. Amen? He will surely comfort us. Now, we know that comfort, you only need comfort when you're in dire straits. If, unfortunately, you lose somebody, you need somebody else to comfort you. If you're in a bad place, sometimes we just wish that you can have somebody just to hold you. Do you understand? Maybe you're just feeling a little bit down or lonely. So the fact that he's used the word comfort is telling you and I that there may be times ahead which may not be pleasant. Amen? Where we just embarked on a new year. But the Lord wants to assure you and I that he will surely comfort you. Amen? So whatever the situation that lies ahead, I'm not here to scaremonger. I'm just here to let us know that the times when we get up and it's not so good, sometimes no matter how we know that we're in the spirit, you just get to a point where sometimes you're feeling a little bit rocky and shaky. He's assuring you and I that he's going to do what? He's going to comfort us. And we know that Zion is a representative of the church. Zion is the church. And so if any adversary or anything comes to destabilize us as a church, he's surely there for us. He is our comfort. Those of us who are from Ghana, we know the name comfort. Don't you just, you hear all the time. When I was a kid, I used to say, why is it everywhere you go, somebody's called comfort? And then to make matters worse, the people that are called comfort, they're called Connie. So I could never understand why it's comfort, then they're called Connie. And then, of course, I'm going to tell you this story, right? There's a young lady that used to live with my mom. She was called Comfort, and everybody called her Connie, right? And so then people moved it from Connie to C. Connie, right? As in C, the name starts with C. So one day she said, I don't understand why people keep calling me C. Connie, because my name actually starts with a W. So I started calling her W. Connie. But it's a name that's very, very common, at least in Ghana, Comfort. And I understand that Noah's name meant comfort, or it means comfort. So we all need comfort at any time. Amen? We may need a C. Connie or a W. Connie, but at some point, we need comfort. But we rest assured that you don't have to look to man for that. In many cases, we may leave you. But the Lord tells you that surely, most assuredly, I'm here for you. He is your comfort and my comfort. I will surely comfort Zion. And he's telling us this year, 2012, that that's what he's going to do. And he's going to look, he doesn't end it there, I love the Lord, and will look with compassion in all her ruins. Remember that Isaiah is speaking to Israel, who is going into captivity, Okay, they're on their way to captivity. It's during the time of Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezra, Daniel, all of them together, that Israel moved from Jerusalem or Israel where they were into captivity with Babylon. Okay, so there was a lot of turbulence going on. There was ruins everywhere. So Isaiah was prophesying to them. So they were in a situation where it seemed like there was no hope. Remember, Isaiah 51 is for those who believe in God. Those who have an intimate relationship with God, and that means you and I. Remember last week I mentioned that we're still in that situation where turbulence is going on everywhere. There's ruins everywhere. Ruins is exactly that. There's ruins. There's no life. So when we look around, whether it's in our job places or whether it's out in the economy, whether the newspaper, even me, I like watching news. Even nowadays, I don't even like to watch the news because, frankly, it's just like, everywhere is just bad. Just think, hold on a minute. I just said, this one got met next one. It seems to be every which way you turn. There's no good news anywhere. There's ruins. But the Lord is telling you and I that the ruins that we find ourselves in, he's going to do what? He will make her deserts like what? Eden. Her wastelands like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her. Thanksgiving and the sound of singing. I wish somebody understands this. This is plain English. Amen. The Lord is telling FCI, the Lord is telling Dorothy, and you want to put your name there, the Lord is telling you that whatever situation you find yourself in, that may be ruins out there, but when it comes to you, he's going to make that desert. We all know what a desert is. Not desert, desert. A desert is dry. It's very arid. In desert, there is no life. You cannot go to the desert and plant tomato trees or whatever, the tomato plants nurture. There's no nurture there. And so this is the situation that we're in. There's no nurture out there. Things, you put things to the ground and it's not responding. They put planting corn, nothing is happening. There's famine everywhere. There's dryness. But the Lord is assuring FCI. And you and I, that situation that is dry, and that is the prophetic word that Pastor has been teaching us. Is that right? From the time that we did a December convention up to January, the prophetic word came. And this word is the same word. It's basically just that we're taking our time to go through scripture. The Lord is telling you and I that though the fig tree does not blossom, though there is no sheep in the pen, though there are no jobs out there, Though there's no money out there, this is our season and time where we will buy cars. This is our season where we will buy houses. This is the time where we will increase. This is the time that your bank balance will never be fatter. But at the same time, if your bank balance is not fat, it's because you've used it to invest. Remember, Pastor said we shouldn't put our money in the bank. Amen? But this is, are we actually understanding this? Are we taking this in? But this is a prophetic word for you and I. Because he tells us that he's going to do what? He's going to make your desert like Eden. You and I know from the beginning, when you read the book of Genesis, that it doesn't say that Eden was a desert, was it? Eden was never a desert. Eden was the garden of the Lord. And when he says in there that in the garden of the Lord is referring to Eden. Genesis 2 from verse 8 to 14. Those of you who are writing notes, please write it down. But I will read it to you. It says this. Now the Lord had planted a garden in the east, in Eden. And there he put the man he had formed. The Lord God made all kinds of trees grow out of the ground. We know it was in a desert. Because in the desert, trees do not grow. Trees that were pleasing to the eye and good for food. In the middle of the garden were the tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. A river watering the garden flowed from Eden. From there it was separated into four headwaters. The name of the first is the Pishon. It winds through the entire land of Havilah where there is gold. The gold of that land is good aromatic resin and onyx are also there. The name of the second river is the Gihon. It winds through the entire land of Cush. The name of the third river, it goes on and it talks about the rivers. Now, the scripture tells us clearly, without argument, I'm sure you're fully persuaded, that the Garden of Eden was not a desert because the trees grew. The trees were good for food. So the Lord is telling you and I that he will feed us. Amen? that we will have plenty to eat. Not just plenty to eat, but plenty to also give and be a blessing. The Bible says that God blessed Abraham because he understood that Abraham would order his household after him and that he would be a blessing to other people. May that be our portion in Jesus' name, because it is, but let's take it in fullness. So this is the assurance that the word of God wants to tell us. It says, joy and gladness will be found in him, thanksgiving and the sound of singing. And therefore, saints, no matter the situation, we must be joyous. We must be glad. Rejoice in the Lord. And again, I say, right? Rejoice in the Lord. Some say, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. For that is our portion. And that is what the Lord will have us understand today. That today is a day of rejoicing. Tomorrow is a day of rejoicing. And for the rest of our lives, it's a day of rejoicing. The Bible says that in all things that we may give him thanks, because it's the will of God concerning you and I. So whether the situation is bitter or sweet, we must be joyous. And that's what he's telling you and I. That this situation that we're in this world, is not going to affect us. It's minus us, because we have a covenant relationship with him. And that is why, going back to the prophetic word, maybe because there was a lot of music, so you may not have heard, the Lord was saying to you and I that we should remain in him. Because if we remain in him and we have that relationship with him, then joy and gladness of a surety will definitely be our portion all the time. And that is why sometimes people go through tough times and challenging times, and other people will ask you, did you hear? Are you all right? Do you understand what I just said to you? I remember once I was made redundant, and my manager called me, and he sat me down and said, Dorothy, you've been made redundant. And I said, okay, thank you. Then he looked at me and said, did you hear what I just told you? I said, yes, I did. Have you finished? Let me go. He was baffled because he was expecting me to do what? To cry or something. Then all I was thinking was, you know what? I need to go and buy myself something, because maybe there'll be challenging financial things ahead of me. So I said, okay, that's fine. Because I understood that by the word of God that God is my provider. So he said, did you understand what I said? Yes, I knew what you said. So as soon as he gave me, when it was lunchtime, guess what I did? I went to the shop and I bought myself an outfit. There's a story to this. So when I got home, after I told Pastor, that's what some of you may have heard Pastor's testimony about when I came to tell him that I was made redundant. But when I got home, this is my side of the story. I shoved the outfit that I bought in my sofa. Those of us who are married women, sometimes we do that. So I shoved it in the sofa and thought to myself, I'll pick it up later and try and convince my husband that it was an old outfit, right? So I put it in the sofa, and I managed to forget about it. Anywho, a few days later, somebody who remained mentionless, that they know themselves, came to my house. And I let me borrow Pastor so that I didn't say it was Ruby, right? But anyway, she came to my house. And as she came to the house, she stood by the sofa, the right place, and put her. And she said, what is this? And she looks at it, and she opened and lifted. What is this? I said, Ruby, put the thing. Put it back. And Pastor said, what's that? I said, oh, it's just an outfit. But let me tell you, going back to the word of God, joy and gladness is our portion and will be found in us always. There's no guarantee that we will not hear that we've been made redundant, but God is our provider. The testimony from that is that when I got a new job, I tell you what, the pay that I received was much more than I had before. That I knew. So I was really excited. I was like, oh my God, I've received, you know, a huge amount. So I started my new job. And about 2 months later, my manager called me and said, Dorothy, you've been given a pay rise. You want to receive that. Amen. So basically, the Lord made up for all that lost time and more. Amen. And he did look after me. So I want to explain to each one of us that joy and gladness will be found in us. Thanksgiving and the sound of singing always. Because if we remain in him and we belong to him, God, who is our provider, his name is Jehovah Jireh, yeah? Jehovah our provider. The thing of Jehovah Jireh is that it's not just God who provides. We like to say our God who provides. But the fullness of it is that our God who sees and then provides. Look at that. That means that you have a different need to me. He doesn't just come and say, okay, everybody, here's some meat. But maybe some people don't eat meat. But what God does, he says, what does Jane eat? Jane eats meat. She likes this, she likes that. But Johnny likes this and that. And so when Johnny comes to the Lord gives Johnny exactly what he needs. Exactly what will satisfy him. Do you understand? Some people like diamonds, some people don't. So if you give somebody a diamond that he doesn't like, he ain't going to appreciate it. Okay? Maybe he likes football boots. I know there's no comparison, but that's what he likes. So when he comes in and God has packaged that football boots for him, oh my goodness, you are such a wonderful God. God, Johnny is happy with his boots. Now here comes Dorothy with the boots. Comes Dorothy to God, and God comes with these beautiful diamonds, and Dorothy says, oh my God, you are my provider. He sees the need and then he provides. Joy and gladness will be our portion. Thanksgiving always. That no matter the situation, we can give him thanks and praise. Amen. And the sound of singing. Whether your voice is a cockroach one or not, it's time for us to lift up our voice. Amen. Listen to me, my people. Hear me, my nation. Instruction will go out from me. My justice will become a light to the nations. The Lord will have us. Remember when we started, I said, anytime we say listen, he wants us to sit up and pay attention. Last week we said that. And he says it again in verse 4. Listen to me. And he doesn't finish it. He says, my people. My people is saying that you and I that have a relationship. It's almost like saying, listen to me, my darling. Listen to me, honey. He's trying to tell you and I that you of us, those of us who have a relationship with me. Amen. Most of us don't go around calling people darling. We know that some people are in the habit of, hello, love, how much, you don't know me, why are you calling me love? But most of us don't do that. We only take our time to call somebody that you have a relationship, that you love. And so when you're saying, hello, honey, hello, my love, hello, darling, sweetheart, whatever, you're actually using it to say that we have that relationship because I love you. That's why I'm calling you that. And he's telling us that, listen to me, my people. Hear me, my nation. Israel is his nation, and we also are his nation, a people that he chose, remember, from the very beginning. FCI, we are a chosen people. We are holy people. A generation that the Lord will use. A ministry that the Lord will use. A ministry that is not just a ministry, but a movement. That all over this world, when, what's his name, William Booth sat up one day and said, I know, I'm going to set up a ministry. He had no idea. The Salvation Army right now, all over the world, in every corner, even in Muslim countries, where everybody knows Salvation Army. He had no idea. And that's what the Lord is going to do with us. And so we are his nation. That all over, you can go to Timbuktu, Papua New Guinea, sorry if you're from there, but the Land's End, John O'Groats, wherever, there will be an FCI. Amen. So he's talking to you and I as an individual, as a church, as a movement, a ministry. He says, instruction will go out from me. Amen. My justice will be a light to the nations. Instruction. An instruction is an order. It's also a direction. It's a knowledge or information imparted. Any movement needs instruction. Any organization needs instruction. An army needs instruction. You cannot just be saying, oh, what should we do? You don't go to work and just say, okay, well, today I decided I'll just paint my nails. There has to be some information, instruction. When you go to school, all over this land, wherever and whatever you're doing, there's instruction. It comes from the top, it goes down, and it goes down. But God himself is telling you and I that we are his people. The order comes from him. And just like we all know, and we like to use the example of the army, that in the army, you know, the other day, my daughter Debian asked me, why are they fighting in Afghanistan? And I sat there for a minute, and I thought, I don't know, I don't really know. Then I thought about it. Then I said, I know it sounds a bit silly to say that, but I said, I'm sure even the people who are fighting don't even know why they're dying. We don't know, but there must be a reason why we're doing that. Because an instruction has come from above. At all costs, they obey. Saints, we thank the Lord that we have instruction from Him. The order comes directly from our Maker. He says that my instruction will go out, or instruction will go out from me. Saints, we cannot build without the Lord. Except the Lord builds a house, we labor in vain that build it. We can do all manner of things without Him, we can't make it. We know that this church is built not on any juju, God forbid, nothing else, but on the word of God. And you and I are a blessed people because we have a man of God whose ear, how do you call it, is directly connected to God's mouth. And so every word that comes from this pulpit and all over FCI, the pulpits that we have, it comes directly from the Lord. And God Himself is telling you and I that in 2012, today and always, if you will allow Him, instruction will come from me. He says, for instruction comes from me. It's about time, saints, that we begin to hear, God, what are you saying in this matter? Oh, I need to do this. Oh, let me call my friend Jane. Let me call my mom. I'm not saying don't get, advice. But let's get instruction from the Lord. That's why we are in a personal relationship. Because Israel at that time was going through challenges. I've already told you, ruins. Some were dying. Some had been taken into captivity. Already Isaiah was warning you, you guys, I'm giving you over to Babylon. Imagine. Whether you had a relationship with him or not, you heard the word coming. That you people, because you've been stiff-necked, I am raising an army. The Babylonians, Nebuchadnezzar was wicked all over the land. He said that no matter what you do, you are going into captivity with Babylon. And in fact, a few days ago, I was reading with interest the book of Jeremiah. And Jeremiah was giving an account about how the people, the remnant that were left, somebody came to kill some of them and somebody else came to rescue them. And then they went to Jeremiah and said, Jeremiah, please pray to God. Let us hear what the Lord says. Whatever God tells us to do, we will do it. And so Jeremiah goes to the Lord and prays. And the Bible says 10 days later, God gave his instruction. And God told Jeremiah, go tell them that they should not go to Egypt. They should not go. They should just stay where they were. But where they were was turmoil. Where they were was barren. Where they were, things were not happening. But the instruction came from God. So saints, sometimes when God speaks to us, we will not understand it. How can God tell them that they should stay in a place where there is death, where things are not happening? But God spoke to Jeremiah and said, let them remain. Don't go anywhere. Because God has a plan for you and I. Amen. So let's hear God's instruction. Whether the instruction is good, bad, or ugly, so long as it comes from the Lord, it surely is good. For all things will work together for good. For those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. While God is in the midst of it, you can be rest assured that it will work for your good. So coming back to this, the people, after Jeremiah spoke to them, they said, no, you Jeremiah, you want to deceive us. We will go to Egypt. And so they ran off to Egypt. And the Bible says that God asked Jeremiah to go and he built some rocks or something. And he said that, you know what? The king of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, because you guys have gone to Egypt, you think that in Egypt you have refuge because the Egyptians will fight the Babylonians. Because of what you have done, Nebuchadnezzar went and took over Egypt. Can you imagine? The Lord is good. His mercy endures forever. Instruction, orders and directions, he says, comes from him. Knowledge or information comes from him. We cannot do without the word of God. We need to remain in him. The instruction comes through the word. As we delve deep into the word, he will give us that instruction. Listen to me, my people. Hear me, my nation. The law will go out from me. My justice will be a light to the nations. Amen. He's going to give us that instruction. He's going to give us direction in all that we do. Amen. Our Lord is good. Amen. He says, the Lord will go out from me. And he says, my justice will become a light to the nations. My righteousness draw near speedily. My salvation is on the way. And my arm will bring justice to the nations. Saints, this is the Lord assuring us. Without a doubt, this word doesn't have, oh, maybe in it. It doesn't have The Lord is making a covenant with you and I. He says, listen to me. He says, my righteousness draws near speedily. That means that his uprightness is coming. He's saying to you that it's coming quickly. That he who is just, he who is upright, he who walks on our behalf and who is justice, it comes speedily. Sometimes people will utter against us. Sometimes it looks like we're being disadvantaged. Sometimes it looks like we've been, as Pastor was teaching us the other day when Paul was saying that, we've been put at the end of the line. In many cases, it seems like that. But the Lord is telling you and I that his righteousness is here and it comes speedily. Saints, don't worry. That's why we need to hear what God is saying in a situation. In some situations, we may need to defend ourselves, like Pastor again has taught. But in certain situations, we may need to sit back and relax and watch the Lord at work. Amen? Sometimes that is the most beautiful time to be. It may look like people say, are you stupid? Do you know why are you quiet? But the Bible tells us that even the Lord Jesus, he was taken like a lamb unto the slaughter. And he did what? He did not open his mouth. He could have opened his mouth. He could have said, all of you die, and they would have died. He could have said, I'm not going. He could have made earthquake come. But the Lord, because he knew his call and what he must do for you and I to benefit, he did not open his mouth. Like a dumb sheep, like we all say. Are you dumb? If somebody says, yeah, are you dumb like a sheep, man, they really insulted you. Because the sheep doesn't open their mouth. Hey, sheep, how you doing? Most of you say, bah. But that's what the Lord reduced himself into. He could have defended himself. He could have brought himself and done all manner of miracles. Yet still, he took himself. So sometimes, we need to ask the Lord again, how should I deal with it? But suffice to say that no matter what happens, his righteousness comes speedily. Amen. It's going to come. My salvation is on the way. And his salvation is right here. Amen. His salvation, he has become my salvation. Moses, I like that. When they went through the Red Sea and all that. And that's where we get that song that we sing. The Lord is my strength and my song. He said, he has become my salvation. He has become my deliverer. He has become my healer. He has become my redeemer. That is what salvation is about. And though at salvation, your point of salvation, he became all of that, he still continues to be all of that. And since he's assuring you and I that his salvation is here, amen? He says, my salvation is on the way. So you are in a predicament. Don't worry. His salvation is on the way. Whatever you need to come out of that situation is going to come through. This is the word of the Lord for you and I. This is a prophetic word. So I want you people to understand. I want each one of us to take this. When you go home, please pray it through. Read it through. You may have even more revelations. Please come, let's share it together. But hear what the Lord is telling you. That's why God keeps telling you, hear me. Listen to me. It means he's placing emphasis. It is important. Because for this year 2012, we need this word to run. We need this word so that we can be stabilized. Amen. We need this word so that it can be a strong foundation for us so that we know what lies ahead of us. Salvation is all of that. Salvation is protection from harm, risk, destruction. And it's also being saved from such things. So it can be, salvation is past. So it means that as you came to the Lord, you were delivered, you were healed, you were made whole. But it's also now. And it also will be. The same way that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He who was and is to come. So the salvation, he says here that it is on the way. If you need it, it's going to come. But right now, you have his salvation. And in the past, you've had his salvation. He who was and is to come. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. He says his salvation is on the way. And my arm will bring justice to the nations. His arm will bring justice. You know what, saints? Sometimes, in fact, if anything, you should, that's why the scripture tells us that we should pray for our enemies. Sometimes if somebody goes deliberately against me, I feel sorry for them. You know why? Because I know that I'm a child of God. And I know that by the time the Lord has finished with them, they're going to be in big trouble. That is the justice of the Lord. As the widow, the Bible tells us in Luke, book of Luke, chapter 18, Bible says that Jesus taught this parable so that we will understand the importance of prayer. He said that there was a widow who had a case in court, but she kept pestering the judge for justice. And the reason why God gave us this parable, apart from the fact that we should learn, to pray and consistently keep coming, he talks about justice in there, because God is a God of justice. It means that it's a God that makes sure that things are done properly. He's a God that administers rightfulness or just conduct. A God who makes sure that the right treatment is given. Sometimes it means that somebody may be deserving of punishment, so they get it. But it also means that we know that our God is the one who speaks on behalf of the poor and stuff like that. It means that sometimes the people that are disadvantaged, we must stand up for, and that's what the Lord does. He's a God of justice. So that means that you and I, we must also walk in that same vein. Not be disadvantaging people that we know are at a disadvantage already. You know, the person is down and you're just kicking in to go even further. But if you can help the person, you must help him up, because his justice is around for you and I. We walk in it, and so we must also exhibit that justice. Do we understand? And the widow in the parable had nobody to talk for her. In those days, women were possessions. So if your husband, your only way you can get something is if your husband is around. Your husband will give it for you. Your husband will speak on your behalf. In some places, and even now even, you cannot walk by yourself as a woman. Do you understand? Your husband has to go with you, talk for you, do all that. So if your husband dies, it means you have no advocate. And sometimes we don't have an advocate. And it's God who is our advocate. The Lord is our advocate. An advocate simply means a lawyer, the one who stands in court. And that is why the scripture tells us that he is the only one that is able to present us faultless before the throne of grace. That is an advocacy, to come before God and say, yes, God, these are my people. This is Dorothy, who I speak on their behalf of. If you have a problem in court, you cannot go, but I represent myself. And you just go, excuse me, yeah, your majesty. So no, that's not protocol in the courtroom. You have to say your honor, your grace for the magistrates, all different things. You may not understand it, or your worship, or whatever, I don't know, the legal people, correct me. There's ways that you must conduct yourself. Because, excuse me, let me show you the paper. No, you cannot just, you have to wait for the judge to approach the bench and say, okay, here I go. You may say, or you may have to refer to a law. And so, in case verses, so-and-so versus so-and-so, section 200, it says that you don't have a clue. How are you going to represent yourself? You need to get somebody who's going to sit down and make it all up. Even sometimes it goes, they just say, oh, no. I mean, this one is not working. So, wait, give me 5 minutes. Let me go back and make sure it works. They speak on your behalf. And that is what the Lord does, speaks on our behalf. And make sure that we get justice. And he's telling you and I that no matter what comes against us, his justice is assured. Amen. His salvation is on the way. And my arm will bring justice to the nations, to you and I. Justice is available to us. And so in the same way, let us make sure we don't keep putting people down. Sometimes we need to be just and make sure. Sometimes, somebody's your friend. And so even if they're doing wrong, you're not able to stand up to them because he's my friend. That is not justice. It's your brother, your sister, somebody you know, and they're going, I can't say, blah, blah, blah. That's not what the Lord does. He says, he who he loves, he chastises. Sometimes he has to punish you and I. Just like as a parent, you whip your child, even though sometimes you don't like it, or you punish your child, but you know that you need to do that so that that child can grow to the level which they need to go. But God's justice is here. His salvation is here. It says this is what we need. Throughout this year, and always, that we will be able to understand. It says the islands will look to me and wait in hope for my arm. Saints, people are looking at us all over. All over. Have you never heard, you've gone to work, you say something, says, but I thought you were Christian. Oh, you've never heard that before? It's just me. But I thought you were Christian, so how come, blah, blah, blah. Sometimes they ask you that, then you may have to explain yourself that, oh yeah, because of this, that, or the other. Sometimes they've got it completely wrong, so you explain to yourself, explain to them. But they're looking, because they know that hope is coming from you. They're looking for examples. They're desperate. They're looking to you. And so he says that the islands will look to me and wait in hope for my arm. The islands means that all over the nation is looking to you and I. For example, as Paul says, he said that we should be living epistles wherever we go, because they don't have the hope. They're looking for you to give them direction, looking for you. Even somebody says, oh, don't pray for me. But they don't want to know your prayer, but they want your advice. It's the word of God you're still giving them. Don't say, oh, you don't want me to pray for you, so I'm not giving you advice. Let them keep coming. One day, they will follow you. One day. They may not follow you, but in their heart, they will know that you are living for Christ. At the end of the day, you might be an example. So saints, wherever we're, in our colleges, in our schools, in our workplaces, on the buses, you really don't know when you're going to meet somebody. Once I was with Debian in Croydon, and I was moaning about something or the other, and as soon as I stepped out, I was like, oh! Then some girl was standing there. She goes, hello, Mama Doe. I looked at her, I had no idea who she was. I said, oh, hello. She said, oh, you don't know me, but I know you because I've been to your church before. Blah, blah, blah. So I said, oh, hello. I looked at them and I said, oh, my God. I mean, you really don't know. I would have set a bad example. But the point I'm making is that the hope is here in this very house. The islands will look to me and wait for hope for my arm. Saints, it's going to be tough out there. The hope, they need to look to us, see how we are progressing, how we are prospering. How come you're not, you're not depressed, you're not on Prozac, even though you've lost your job? How come this and this is happening to you, but you're still happy, you're still smiling? What is the matter? Have you gone mad? Oh no, but this is it. We need to make a difference, saints. For God is working on our behalf. You want to rise in me because we don't have much time. Saints, the islands are looking to us for hope. You want to lift up your voice and say, Lord, this year and always, I've got to surrender myself to you. That you cannot do without him. But you need him. You want to commit yourself in prayer to God. You want to lift up your voice and thank the Lord for the salvation that is available to us.
Our mission is raising overcomers, setting the captives free. Freedom Center International is here to support you in every step that you take with the Word of God as you seek spiritual and emotional wholeness. And we hope you've been blessed by today's message. Worship with us at 38 Upper Wickham Lane, Welling, Kent, DA16-3HF, or give us a call on 0207-277-8700. You can also visit us online at fcichapel.org. And remember, there is progress in freedom.